very appropriate when we think about the provenance and the achievement of Kaz's work, because certainly for me as a reader, Kaz's work both inaugurates but also asks us to join a number of conversations. I mean, conversations as readers with his characters, but also to get us involved in conversations of a wider historical and geographical provenance happening across different times and places, conversations with history, as we were thinking about this morning, and also the ways in which, for me as a reader, Carol's work asks that we have conversations with ourselves as we're invited to explore our existing sense of how the world turns and what new world orders might be possible if we engage and think across the range of issues that Kaz has engaged with in his work over many years. So a conversation seems an appropriate mode for us to have an encounter with you this afternoon, Kaz. So thanks very much indeed for being here.
Well, excuse me, thanks to Fran, of course, and to people that organised this conference and to those people who have travelled from many places to come here. Thanks to you too. Yeah. We've done this, you know. John is from the city I grew up in, so we're kind of familiar with each other. But thank you as well, John, for agreeing to talk to me.
A pleasure. Maybe we could begin by focusing on place and the significance of place for your writing. As we'll no doubt talk about, your writing looks across and takes us to a number of places in the world. But maybe a nice place to start would be here in France. France is one of the places that you've written about, both in your fiction and your non-fiction. And of course, you came to France, I think, as you've written, in 1980. A couple of reasons, one of which was to meet up with James Baldwin. So I wonder if I could just begin by asking you to share your thoughts or your reflections on the importance or the significance of France for you, as a writer over the years.
Oh, good question. France, the first importance that France has is, like most students in Britain of the late 70s, 80s, before the Channel Tunnel, beat a passage across the channel on a cross-channel ferry and took the train to Paris from Calais or somewhere and then got drunk on the left banks, disported themselves badly, stayed in cheap hotels in Pigalle, and thought you were being exotic and bohemian. And so I did all of that. And it's whilst Britain still imagines that it's part of Europe, it's close, it's close to Britain, it's the nearest place. So if you don't have much money and you want to have an exotic adventure and you're British and you've left college, you go to France, you go to Paris and you get drunk and you hang out and you go to the Jeu de Paume and you go to the Louvre. And it's fun. And so that was my first encounter. Then a couple of years after that, there was a more serious encounter in Saint-Paul-de-Vence when I was making a film with I can't call him James because I never called him James. I was making a film with Jimmy Baldwin and got to understand the importance of France in a larger cultural way to all sorts of expats from various corners of the world, including, of course, African Americans, but many people who had found a way to begin again in France, who regarded France in a similar way to that New York has been regarded in the 20th century as a place of anonymity, a place where you can reinvent yourself. Well, Paris was that. And France was that for many artists from around the world, Diaghilev, lots of them. Picasso, the Spaniard. So talking to Jimmy, I got to understand France's significance in a different way, and particularly what it meant to African Americans after the First World War, and then again after the Second World War. So always felt not just geographically close to France, but because of Jimmy was the first writer I ever knew. So because of him, I feel close to France too.
Because I knew you became friends, and I wouldn't want to intrude upon the privacy of that friendship, but wondering if you could share with us a sense of, in fact, I'll call him Jimmy too, Jimmy's importance and significance to you as someone who was keen to become a writer, and you know, the how important it was to be a role performance example for someone who deserves to be a writer.
Jimmy always said it was unlikely, you know, that he would ever become a writer, because he wasn't, people who looked like him in America in the middle part of the 20th century were not supposed to be writers. People who looked like William Faulkner or Arthur Miller or Tennessee Williams or, you know, any number of people I could name, they were supposed to be writers. The people who looked like him were not supposed to be writers. Well, it was the same for me in Britain. People who looked like me were not supposed to be writers. My parents' generation didn't come to England with any literary credentials, with any literary history. Of course, when we look at the canon now, we do know that people like Selvon and Wilson Harris and George Lamming and Vidya Naipaul did arrive with literary credentials. But the general consensus of the British audience, or the British public, was that people who looked like me were not writers. And so in a sense we had that in common, that we were not expected to be that. He said to me once in St. Paul de Vence, you know, I'm not ever going to be anything but a performing dog to these people. And he didn't mean French people, he meant Americans. And the expectation, which goes with the judgmental gaze, always involved dissonance. And it does for me too. It does for me.
My sense of those writers is, in order for them to become the writers they became, they kind of had to leave. Mm. And there's something problematic and sad and wrong about that on the one hand. But on the other hand, something productive, that leaving, migrating, moving, means that dissonance can resound in other kinds of ways.
Writers are always leaving. You know, Ibsen left Norway, Joyce left Ireland, Brodsky left Russia. You know, writers leave. Is it sad? If it enables you to do your work, it's not sad. So, you go where you can get the work done. You know, you do what you've got to do.
Remember, Derek Walcott once said, or once wrote, we read, we travel, we become. I think is a wonderful quotation. I've thought of that before when I've been reading your work, and the relationship between movement and travelling, and writing and vision, and creativity.
You know, I'm an immigrant. You know, I came to England when I was 4 months old, so my parents inculcated into my spirit the notion of travel very early. And travel usually involves growth. You know, when I'm teaching, you know, students sometimes come to my office asking advice, you know. And I nearly always say the same thing, you know, what are you going to do when you graduate? You know, I like the students who say, the students I trust are the ones who say, I don't know. You know, the ones who say, well, I'm like, no, stop, rest. You've had 21 years of, 18 years of compulsive education, stop it, you know. Just take a breather. And what's the source of great growth is travel, because travel involves encounter. And that encounter with people who are not you, who speak languages you don't speak, who have different cultural practices from you, who look at you in a way that is perhaps peculiar to you, but is challenging to you in some way, will engender growth. So travel will engender growth. So I think, for me, it's a great gift that my parents migrated. I mean, it's a practical gift, because I got an education in Britain that I would never have got in the Caribbean. My parents lost a lot by migrating, because any migrant family loses something, anybody. Migration involves loss, but it also involves a form of gain too. You just got to identify what are the positives from that. But generally speaking, travel engenders growth. So if you're lucky enough to be able to travel, travel. So I don't regard it as a reductive or necessarily problematic element of my life or anybody else's life. It's just, you know, what's the residue you have to deal with? Displacement. Not having a sense of rootedness or belonging sometimes, which is can be uncomfortable. Yeah, journeys have been central to my life. But remember, I didn't get on a plane until I was 20. You know, I'd never been anywhere until I was 20 years. I'd never been, it's bonkers, because I never seemed to be off the bleeding thing. I never got on one until I was 20. I remember the first time I stepped on a plane, I thought, there's a lot of seats on this thing. And they're all kind of squished up together. And it was, I remember really clearly looking at this DC-10 or whatever it was, and thinking, and then it deposited me in, as it turned out, New York in 1978, which was hell. It was the height of graffiti and hip-hop. New York was hell. Son of Sam. It was, you know, serial killers on every corner. It scared the hell out of me. But it's all, it was good. It was good, because it kind of wasn't like that at Oxford.
I mean, did you have a sense when you landed in New York in 78 that that was a city that would become such an important place
for
you?
No, I hated the place. I hated it. It scared the hell out of me. It scared me. If you'd have told me I'm going to come back and live there, I'd have said, you're bonkers. There's no way I'm coming back to this place. But, you know, I was talking to somebody yesterday when I was in Paris about the first encounter with Venice. I first saw Venice when I was in my 20s, and I wasn't old enough. Because I'm thinking, where do you get a cab in this town? I wasn't old enough to fully appreciate what Venice means. And it's staggering beauty. But the same with New York. I wasn't old enough. I was just, you know, I just thought somebody was going to kill me on the subway, and I'm not going to get a degree.